Our story begins in Boston, on a bridge that spans the river in the heart of the city. Nancy, a college student, is on her way to the library. And oops, there go her books. But along comes a knight in armor, or anyway, a sophomore on a scooter. It's Tom Chatfield from her French class. And it just so happens he's the one man in school Nancy would most like to be rescued by. Tom tells her he's on his way to his job as a dockmaster at Community Boating, a public sailing program. Every time Nancy sees a boat, she wishes she knew how to sail. Tom says he'd like very much to teach her, and this is the perfect place to start. The Charles River Basin is one of the finest water playgrounds in the country. The Metropolitan District Commission, an agency of the Commonwealth, has, with real foresight and purpose, preserved this beautiful river area and provided a fleet of boats for the use of the public. So there's an adventure in store for Nancy. She's already a good swimmer, the only qualification you need for becoming a sailor. Nancy's looking forward to the hours of recreation on the water and the challenge of learning a new sport. And of course, she's looking forward to having Tom teach her. Learning to sail, Tom tells Nancy, is easier than learning to drive a car. After 4 or 5 sessions of instruction in a boat, she should be ready to handle one all alone. The wind is what makes your boat go. When you sail, you must always be aware of the wind, which way it's blowing, how strong the gusts are. Watch the wind blowing that smoke. Now look at the action of the wind in sails. Here they're luffing in a lazy breeze. You'll soon learn to check the sails of your own boat when you're on the water, just as if it were an instrument panel of a car. Most of all, watch the wind on the water. You'll notice that the darker the color of the water, the heavier the gusts. After just a little practice, you can see the wind on the water for yourself. It's important for a sailor to learn to forecast the weather, but when in doubt, he can always pick up the phone and dial forecast. Well, almost always. Now here's Nancy all set for her first lesson. Tom's going to get in a boat and show her how to come about. To come about means to turn the front of the boat across the wind with the wind ahead. To do this, the skipper puts the tiller all the way over toward the sail. He holds the end of the tiller extension so as to get the full sweep of the rudder while still keeping his weight opposite the sail. Now watch this boat come about 3 more times. The skipper is sailing high into the wind, which is coming from the opposite shore ahead of him. The wind is hitting the left or port side of his boat, so he's sailing on what is called a port tack. He's going to put the front of his boat across the wind and come about onto the other tack. He puts the tiller all the way toward the sail. Then when the sail crosses, he goes to the other side of the boat. He always sits opposite the sail. You'll notice that after the front of the boat has crossed the wind hits the sail from the other side. The skipper holds his tiller over while the sail fills on the new tack. Now the wind is hitting the left side of the sail again, and once more he's on a port tack. Ready to come about, hard a lee. Meanwhile, Nancy is practicing coming about inshore. Tiller all the way toward that sail. Here's Tom coming about again. The tiller goes toward the sail. He holds it all the way over so the boat keeps on turning across the wind and the sail fills with wind on the other side. Now, watch him slack his sail when he's hit by a good strong puff. It looks exciting. Oops, maybe too exciting. A question that often stumps beginners is, what's the difference between coming about and jibing? The boat shown here will alternately come about at the right of the screen and then jibe at the left. First, the front of the boat is turned across the wind. This is called coming about. The bow turns across the wind with the wind ahead.
and then the back of the boat is turned across the wind. This is called jibing. The stern crosses the wind with the wind behind. The wind here is blowing from the dock where we're watching, blowing in the direction of the opposite shore. The front edge of a sail is hitched to the mast while the back edge is flying free. When you come about, you turn the front of the boat across the wind. The hitched edge of the sail goes into the wind, so nothing very exciting happens. This is the safe way to turn. But when you turn the back of the boat across the wind behind catches the free-flying outside corner of the sail and whips it across the boat. If the skipper doesn't manage his jibe just right, the wind can really slam-bang that sail over with enough force to unbalance the boat or even capsize it. Later on, we'll show you how to do a jibe the right way and how to make it a real smooth maneuver. Now watch this boat come about. The front of the boat turns across the wind with the wind ahead. You can tell exactly where the wind is blowing when a boat comes about because as the sail crosses over, the bow of the boat is pointed right into the wind. And here it jibes. The back of the boat is turned across the wind with the wind from behind. In a jibe, at the moment the stern of the boat crosses the wind, the sail whips across to the other side. Now she comes about once more. Now what does the skipper do in a jibe? His job is to outwit the wind, to keep it from slamming the sail in a whole semicircle. The skipper can take the force out of the maneuver, first by pulling the sail in before he jibes, that takes half the arc away from the wind, and then by letting the sail run out the minute the wind catches it on the other side. Ready to jibe, he sets the tiller away from the sail and pulls the sail in fast, then lets the sheet in his hand run out. The most important thing in the jibe is never to allow the wind to hit a tight wall of sail. That can really rock the boat. Let the sheet in your hand run freely at the very first tug of the wind. It doesn't even matter if you drop it completely. In fact, that's a good thing to do in any emergency. It spills the wind out of the sail. It's always a good idea before you jibe to check and see if by any chance the line has somehow managed to sneak itself under or around your feet. No use letting that sheet run out through your hand if you have a big foot stamped down on it, holding it tight. You know that the sail in the jibe is going to cross over fast, so you have to plan to have your weight on the side opposite where the sail is going to land when that jibe is completed. In coming about, on the other hand, the sail moves over slowly, so you move over slowly. Now he's ready to jibe again. He holds the tiller away from the sail, pulls in the sail and lets it run. After the jibe, he straightens the tiller out to prevent another jibe happening right away by mistake. And here's Nancy inshore practicing the jibe. Remember, tiller away from the sail and body holding it over. Now here's a jibe shown in slow motion. Tom will turn the back of the boat across the wind with the wind from behind. That wind behind wants to catch the outside corner of the sail and slam it across to the other side. But Tom keeps it from being too much of a slam. He pulls the sail into the center of the boat. At the first tug of the wind, he lets the sail run right out. And here's the jibe once more at regular speed. The trouble with the jibe is that there are several things that can go wrong, and sometimes they all happen at once. Perfect timing is the thing. A jibe should be a veritable symphony of motion. But if the skipper has his weight on the wrong side when the sail goes over,
or if he lets things go to pieces and ends up wrong side to or upside down, well, he better take up ping pong, that's all. We'll now show you that magnificent maneuver called the accidental jibe. Needless to say, this is not the way to sail a boat. When a skipper is contemplating outer space, he doesn't notice that lifting boom. He doesn't feel the sheet go slack in his hand till whammo, over she goes. He's wide awake now, though, and lucky if he hasn't taken in a bit of water as well. Here's Tom and Nancy, and they're taking off together in a lively breeze. And Nancy's not too sure she's going to like this. But Tom shows her how she can control the tipping of the boat. When she pulls on the sheet, the wind pushes against the tight sail and the boat heels. With the sheet loose, the boat flattens right out. You can't sail a boat directly into the wind. There's a whole piece of pie there, almost a quarter of a circle, you can't sail into. So when you want to sail in the direction the wind is coming from, you have to proceed in zigzags, sailing along as high into the wind as you can. First you sail along the edge of the wind on one tack, then you come about and sail along the edge of the wind on the other tack. Here we see two boats sailing along toward the wind. They're both actually heading as directly as they can for the dock we're watching them from, and they're tacking toward us and toward the wind. One zigs while the other zags. When boats have to take a number of tacks on a course into the wind, it's called beating to windward. Well, here goes Nancy, all ready for her first solo. She wishes now she'd paid more attention to what Tom was saying about sailing, instead of wondering if he'd ever ask her to crew for him in a race. Well, she's off. Why, there's nothing so alarming about this. In fact, she's not going so awfully fast. Well, the truth of the matter is, she's really not going at all. Now, let's see. You can't sail directly into the wind. Oh, dear, where is that wind? The spectators here make you feel like an idiot. Nancy thinks maybe she'd better take a few more lessons and keep her mind strictly on navigation. When heading into or across the wind, a sailboat is in stays. Next comes a boat sailing as high as it can to the wind. This is sailing close-hauled. Sailing close-hauled, the skipper pulls the sail in close and makes adjustments with the tiller to hold the boat as high as he can into the wind and still move along. He keeps a sharp eye on the sail near the mast, for here he can tell when he's pointing too high by the flutter of a luff. Here the skipper, sailing close-hauled, is seen from astern. Notice that he holds the sail still while he watches for the least luff and makes adjustments to the little changes in the wind by moving his tiller. After close hauled comes close reach, and then beam reach, with the wind coming in a beam or directly over the side. Now the skipper sets his course and then makes the adjustments with his sail to keep it full of wind. He can do this by letting the sail out till it luffs a little, then pulling it in till the luffing stops. That's the point of maximum efficiency. On a broad reach, the wind is coming in towards the stern, and your sail is way out, right over the water. And with the wind directly astern, the boat is running before the wind, or running. Whatever the position of the sail, it's important to keep an attentive eye on it. A good skipper is always checking his sail.
When you come into the dock, you plan to land your boat into the wind so that the wind blowing against the boat acts as a brake. It's a good idea to let your sail go loose while you're still quite away from the dock. This slows you up and keeps you from making a crash landing. Here comes Tom making a nice landing, sail luffing freely, to let the boat coast to a stop. He pulls up alongside the dock like parking a car at the curb. And here comes Nancy, but she's coming in downwind. This way, the wind, instead of acting as a brake, sweeps her right along the dock. Tom is thinking that maybe he'll ask Nancy to crew for him in the races this Sunday. And then he sees her landing. Tom tells her to take off and try once again. Nancy's feeling rather discouraged. She's sure Tom thinks she's not learning a thing. And she's determined to make this landing a real good one. It is a good one, of its kind. Calm in the face of shipwreck and romantic disaster, Nancy does exactly the right thing. Off comes the rudder first, the part of the boat most likely to be damaged by rocks near the shore. Next, down comes the sail to relieve pressure from the wind driving the boat onto the shore. Lowering the sail is also the distress signal. It will bring the launch to the rescue. After she has the sail down, Nancy will manage to tuck it up neatly instead of leaving it flopping around in the boat. Finally, she pulls up the centerboard so the boat can float free. Nancy is ready to give up sailing and take up golf. But Tom, who's watched the rescue from the dock, feels pretty proud. Any fool can sail along on the water, but it isn't everyone who can go aground with such savoir-faire. A boat is sometimes treacherously attacked by a bridge. Nancy was just sailing along, minding her own business, when the bridge somehow sneaked up on her. It's too late for her to jibe out of the situation. In fact, once more, Nancy must resign herself to fate and lower that sail. Well, it's just not Nancy's day. This time she decides there's no point in fighting back, so she steers a safe middle course. She always did want to see what's on the other side of the bridge anyway. Nancy was pretty discouraged. But Tom just laughed about her battle with the bridge. He said, "It's not very windy, it's a perfect day for sailing," and off he went alone. Of course, he knows Nancy's watching, so he really heels that boat over. Whoops! Crash boat to the rescue, and Nancy joins the rescue party. A capsize is always potentially dangerous, not only to the people in the boat, but also to the equipment. Sails get torn, masts stick in the mud. Tom, of course, has obeyed the most important rule of all, though. Stay with the boat. Not very windy, Nancy teases Tom. Perfect day for sailing. And she finds the day a bit damp. Nancy's days as a beginner are now past. She's learned how to sail a boat, and Tom finally asked her to crew for him. Today, Nancy and Tom are sailing in a fast little planing boat that calls for real coordination of skipper and crew. By moving their weight, by handling of the sails, they really keep this boat flying along on the water. After you've learned to sail a small boat with one sail, you understand how all boats sail. Then you're ready for new adventure. Added sails, jib and spinnaker. Perhaps a twin-hull catamaran, or a cruising boat that can take you on a real sea voyage. Or maybe your final love will be the constant excitement and challenge of small boat sailing. Pleasures in sailing are as varied as the people who sail. You may find excitement in it, or peace. You may find lots of friends and the companionship of those who sail and love the sea. Or for you, it may mean the serenity that comes when you are alone with a boat, the water, and the wind. But for everyone, sailing is a new world to be explored.